You're listening to the audio production of God Knows, When Your Worries and Whys Need More Than Temporary Relief, by Lisa Whittle, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
For my daughter Shay, and to every other person reading this, only God knows everything about. Just breathe. He's on it. Introduction. How God Knows can help you. In a sea of book options and with the looming stack of to-be-read books on your bedside table, I can think of three reasons you might have felt compelled to pick up God Knows. Number one, you're in pain and want relief. Number two, you're afraid and want reassurance. Number three, you're desperate for hope and at this point aren't picky about how you get it. In each of these instances, you must believe on some level that God can provide those things for you because you've been drawn to the idea that He knows what's happening in the world and in your world. Good news, you aren't wrong. God does know. Besides the proof through otherwise impossible timing, acts of providence, and what people like to call God winks, we have proof from many places in the Bible. I particularly love how the NIV version of the Bible says it in 1 John 3:20 so simply. God is greater than our hearts, and He knows everything. There's not one thing you did yesterday, face today, or will go through tomorrow that God doesn't know about. That statement could be the end of it if we didn't take issue with our struggle. We have questions, and God is good with them. We may not get the answers we want, but asking means we are interested. Why, God? Don't you see God? Will you help, God? Can't you understand how this hurts, God? At some point, we will want to understand what it really means for us day to day that God knows about our lives. If we break this down further, here are our main questions. How can God knowing help me in what I'm going through? Our own history with knowledge has proven it inadequate to solve the world's problems. It's helpful with good decision-making and becoming better people, perhaps, but information is unable to change terrible news, prevent sadness or sickness, or drive us into productivity. I've known plenty of people who were knowledgeable and who suffered, brilliant, but stuck. If we are using ourselves as the measuring stick, it is no wonder we would assume less of God's all-knowing. But God's knowledge is not on our level, so we are dealing with a different set of rules. Maybe you've never considered His omniscience important as you drive through Starbucks every day for your hit of liquid energy, but you couldn't be more wrong. You being at Starbucks is under the umbrella of how the God of the universe has intimate knowledge of you even in your regular life. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. Psalm 139, verses 3 and 4. How does God's knowledge alone change anything? Where our knowledge requires additional steps to be effective, God's knowledge is itself an action. It is complete, an entire sovereign system. Because it involves no parameter or limit, there is no process required to find out more information or meet more criteria to help. The whole picture is tied into a permanent and supernatural character trait of a perfect and limitless God, not a limited measurement tied to a shifting, imperfect human decision maker prone to bias and error, aka you and me. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Isaiah 55, verse 9. In comparing our knowledge to God's, may we see the critical distinctions and be more eager than ever to surrender our attempts to self-manage. God's omniscience is a system of perfection. It has no gaps. It is not a nebulous concept. His knowing what is going on in our world is him working on our behalf. Those two things cannot be separated. When we understand that, we see how God's knowledge is crucial in our day-to-day lives. While God's omniscience is not completely definable by human minds like ours, it is important to dive into it because right now we need some relief and security. When we understand he's got the whole world in his hands is more than a slogan or a mirror cling, we can sleep better at night. And he has been gracious enough to tell us some things about himself that we can understand. The Bible tells us he is pure, unbiased, always aware, trustworthy, thorough, lasting, redemptive, and, maybe most important on many days to our tender hearts, fully for us. The Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. Psalm 84, verse 11. Our sun and shield, favor and honor. That is enough to hang our futures on. No matter how I feel some days, I certainly feel much more solid believing in a God like this than banking it all on empty positive vibes. There is more to God's knowledge than what I listed, of course. It's important to understand the omniscience of God is not just facts to know about him. His omniscience is facets of his nature that translate into our daily sustaining. His all-knowing is for our well-being. I'm awed that God can be so good to us to share himself for our benefit. And I'm grateful. Because life is hard, we might think he sure doesn't feel good all the time. Things don't go well all the time, absolutely. If God knows everything, then why would he allow bad things? Why do we experience the constant tinge of worry? Why do we spend so much time fighting for injustices that seem to continue and having no answers when difficulties happen to us? Shouldn't we feel more secure? There are some reasons we don't feel more secure, comforted, and relieved, even though we might know that God is in control. Hold on to your hat, because I say this bluntly. Number one, we are doubters. We can't see God working, so we have a hard time believing he has things under control. Number two, we are impatient. We want things fixed, solved, and vindicated on our timetable. Number three, we are controlling. We want things done our way all the time. Number four, we are selfish. We want a perfect life, no problems, and things skewed in our favor. Number five, we want to be God ourselves. This is a hard one to swallow, so we generally overlook it. In some ways, it's a combination of all the above, but it goes deeper. Stick with me, because this is crucial. Do you wish you had the power to make everything right in the world, to undo, redo, fix, or solve things, or make everything hard go away by your abilities? We might not come right out and say we wish we could be God, but it is something nearly every person who has ever lived has wanted to do. We've all been looking for a way to escape the basic realities of being a human since God breathed his ruach, spirit, into us and we became nephesh, a living soul. Then the Lord formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. Genesis 2, verse 7. Adam didn't become God in that moment, of course, nor did we in the human lineage. Adam breathed in God. Rather, God breathed his life into him to fill his otherwise lifeless, dust-formed body and bones. Without his breath, we wouldn't have existed. And in it, we were intended to begin a lifetime relationship of reliance. Without his breath now, we cease to be. He could have breathed himself into Adam and made him and all the rest of us his clones. But instead, he wanted to make us humans, given life, but dependent upon his. God intended that we would rely upon him for our very breath until we breathe our last and enter into his physical presence where we will need human breath no more. Until then, he promised to provide all we need. Wisdom and understanding, strength when we are weak, presence in our lack and loneliness, It was and is a perfect scenario. We just don't like the reliance part. Yes, our quest for reliance has proven to be an enormous battle, and desiring knowledge is the place we have historically been the most tempted to challenge God. Why? Because Satan has long been luring us there. His goal to get us to self-destruct in pride and control is an easier sell in the innocent packaging of the good thing of knowing more. Genesis 2 and 3 prove this point. As chapter 2 introduces us to the scene, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden," verses 15 and 16. Genesis 3 shows us the manifestation of the temptation. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die." "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Verses 1 through 6. We want to know when we don't understand. We want to control when things are not controllable. We struggle with reliance. We want to do God's job, but we aren't very good at it. We've proven that. I'm not here to try to work miracles in the next 8 chapters. I can't work a miracle in your life anyway. What I hope to do instead is give some insight and tools to get us at least closer to being people who gain their hope and strength from deferring to God. I am praying that you walk away from this book feeling like the words "God knows" mean something far deeper than a saying you might wear on a shirt. I hope you start to say them when your world is caving in around you. My prayer is that you will have found a new way to breathe in and out life, a new way of coping, a new perspective and level of trust in more than yourself. For the do-it-yourselfers, you might be glad to know that in this book, I am offering one to do, but it may not be in the way you usually think about it. Since learning more about ourselves hasn't improved our angst, but has in many ways increased it, self-discovery brings unending to-do lists. We will take a breather from our search to know ourselves better and instead get to know more about God. Learning about the nature of Christ changes the way we function as people. The more we trust in His omniscience, the more we will rest in a world we don't understand. When we rely upon a quality of God that is unchanging, we remove the instability of self-improvement that causes exhaustion and insecurity. For the skeptics, maybe leaning into God's omniscience sounds too good to be true because you have heard it all and you're a skeptic. I write this book as one myself, if that matters at all. I am far more frightened by people who never ask questions than by people who ask too many, and I almost always play devil's advocate, even with myself. So in case you wonder if we have to wear rose-colored glasses to believe that God knowing everything is a good thing, quite the opposite is true. There is value in skepticism. Skeptics question. They dig. They consider every solution before allowing themselves to be convinced. That is the place from which I've written this book. Questions, and even critiques, are often the way zealous converts to faith in Jesus first start and become most convinced about Him. There is a lot I don't profess to know, but certain things I am increasingly sure of. God knows things we never will. He is actively working on our behalf, even when we do not realize it. Our way of trying to bring ourselves comfort and relief hasn't worked, isn't working, and won't work in the future. And God being God, and us being us, means that when I say God knows, I mean God is doing the job we are attempting to do. His breath has given us life, but His life itself is what makes it possible for us to keep living. Ruach to nefesh, His Spirit breathing life into our souls in the beginning and ongoing. No matter why you picked up this book, we are all here for a bigger reason. We need help. We need comfort and relief. We need God. He is the only one for the job, and He is on it. May the skeptics be changed, the weary be renewed, and the hopeless find hope in what He knows that we do not. Start here. Will you do something with me? Think of the burden.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.